In this movie, we'll look at some of the ways in which phonological representations interact with phonetic realizations. First, we'll look quickly at an example of how a given word might have very different phonetic realizations while maintaining the same abstract phonological representation. It all has to do with meaning. The phonological level has to do with how sounds are used to convey meaning. So, if I say an isolated sound, such as there's no meaning that's conveyed. That's because sounds, by themselves, don't have meanings. It's only when we combine sounds into sequences that meaning can be associated. So, if I produce these four sounds together, this symbol is used to represent the sound y, and this symbol is used to represent the sound j, then the word that I produce is huge. But anyone who's spent much time in East Coast cities such as New York will know that not everyone says it this way. In fact, in New York, it's increasingly common to hear people say huge. If we're going to represent this production phonetically, then we have to write it differently, like this. Now remember, the word doesn't mean anything different when someone from New York uses it. It just sounds different. And since we want our transcription to reflect how words sound, then we might well have two different ways of transcribing this same word. And it doesn't stop there. Huge is a frequently occurring production in a particular dialect of English, the dialect mostly spoken in New York. But any speaker, regardless of their dialect, might well produce this word with a slightly different beginning sound. Listen to these two productions and hear how they sound different at the beginning. Huge. Huge. The second one might be said when a speaker is more excited than usual. As in, last night's win for the Blazers was absolutely huge! Now, at the level of meaning, the word still means huge. It's not a different word. But at the level of the speech sounds that are actually produced by the speaker, there is something that's a little different. Huge has the h sound at the beginning, but huge has something else, a sound that's produced with the back of the tongue and a more low-pitched, hissy kind of sound. We call this sound a velar fricative, more on why later, and we use this symbol to represent it. So when we go to transcribe the production huge, we'll transcribe it this way. But when we transcribe the production huge, we'll want to represent the velar fricative because that's what the speaker produced. So we'll transcribe it this way. And if we're in New York, then we might well transcribe some speakers' productions of the word this way. What's important here is that all of these productions have the same meaning. Therefore, we say that the word huge has a specific phonological representation that's constant. It doesn't change from speaker to speaker. We might well write it this way. But we also know that actual speakers might vary in their productions of this word, and we want to represent those variations, too. Those variations occur at the phonetic level, and when we refer to phonetic transcription, we're usually referring to this level. You'll see that one of these phonetic transcriptions happens to look the same as the phonological representation given above. This often happens, and it's important to remember that even though a phonological representation and a phonetic realization might look the same, we're still talking about two different levels of representation when we use these two ways of representing sounds. So, which one is right? They both are. Rightness depends in part on what level of representation you're looking at. So this is one example of how phonological representations might relate to words as they're actually produced. Here's one other. In many languages, there are certain things that just don't happen with sounds. For example, in English, there aren't any words that begin with this sound sequence. Why not? No reason, there just aren't. Most English speakers have never thought about this, and yet English speakers show consistent agreement that made-up words that start with pwa are less word-like than made-up words that have real English consonant clusters at the beginning. For example, If asked to rate how word-like these two words are, the made-up word clast would be rated much higher than the made-up word poast. Even though speakers might not know why they rate one of these words as seeming more like a word than the other, they agree with a surprising level of consistency. This consistency is part of what tells us that English speakers have a level of knowledge about this quirky aspect of the English speech sound system. This is a kind of phonological knowledge that English speakers have, and they demonstrate this knowledge implicitly, even though they can't explain any of it explicitly. Phonological knowledge is abstract. We can't see it or hear it, since it exists only in the mind of a speaker of a language, and even there it exists mostly implicitly, hidden from awareness of the speaker themselves. So we have to infer what phonological knowledge consists of based on patterns we notice in the things that we actually can see and hear. And what we can see and hear are the actual productions of speakers. In other words, we can see and hear the phonetic level of representation. And we use that evidence to infer what phonological knowledge must consist of by analyzing productions at the phonetic level. So we have these two levels of representation, phonetic and phonological, that relate to each other. Which one is more important? Neither, and both. As before, it all depends what level of representation you're looking at, though it's important to remember that the two levels will always relate to each other. So anytime you look at the phonetic level, you have to keep the phonological level in mind, and vice versa. Phonetics doesn't exist without phonology, and we wouldn't know much about phonology if it weren't for phonetics.